Welcome back to part 2 of our 2-part series about
aliens.
Where are they? And why don't we see them? Why aren't they here?
But I'm right here. Hello, humans. I'm right here. Hello.
That was a very good question. And if you've missed the awesome part 1, make sure you click the I above and watch it right now.
Do it.
Another one. Those are aliens. Those are aliens that come in the same area. The same area. Those are aliens coming down here, y'all. Look at it's coming down the same direction. Oh, it's breaking up. Oh, it's 6, it's 8, it's 9. Oh, shit. Oh, shit. Look at that. Oh, look. Look at that. They stop. They stop. Look at that shit. Those are aliens!
Sorry, I'm trying to
record it. Aliens! Aliens!
Oh, they cut the lights off.
Aliens!
Oh, they cut the lights
off. Y'all need to be shooting that! Y'all need to be shooting this shit right here! They looking at us! They dividing! They dividing up! We getting invaded!
Disappointed!
So let's try to estimate how many intelligent species there are in the Milky Way galaxy.
For that, we have to take a look at the famous Drake equation. The Drake equation, named after its creator, the famous astronomer Frank Drake, gives an estimate for the possible number of intelligent civilizations in the Milky Way galaxy. We start with a biotic Drake equation, which evaluates the number of planets in the galaxy with any form of biological life, denoted by NB. Some of the parameters we know very well. Among those are the star birth rate in the galaxy, the fraction of stars suitable for the evolution of life, the fraction of stars that have planets, and then the fraction of Earth-sized rocky planets, and then the number of these planets in the habitable zone of their parent star. Less known are the biological factors, which determine the probability for life arising on a planet with the right conditions, and the average longevity of life. A 2014 paper, link in the description, estimates NB using data from the now-defunct Kepler Space Telescope, and best estimations for the unknown factors. Interested viewers can read up how these factors are obtained in the paper. So the result is that there are between millions and billions of planets with life in the galaxy alone, depending on pessimistic or optimistic choice of parameters. But what about the number of intelligent civilizations, NC? Because advanced alien civilizations are certainly more interesting than bacteria. FC denotes how many civilizations would be willing to communicate, and LC denotes for how long they would be broadcasting. Note that this is meant for a communication with radio waves. The result depends again on the choice of parameters, but we arrive pessimistically to around 10 civilizations and up to the order of thousands of civilizations in an optimistic case. So quite a big uncertainty there. Interestingly, the author of the paper comes to the conclusion that even in the best case, the probability of a civilization lying within a radius of 100 light years from us and broadcasting radio signals that we could receive is a staggeringly low 0.1%. This is another reason why the Fermi Paradox does not exist in our opinion. It is absolutely logical that we haven't found an intelligent alien civilization yet. Actually, it would be an insane stroke of luck if we had already found one.
Science fiction authors came up with concepts of interstellar empires, such as in Isaac Asimov's Foundation series, or of course George Lucas' creation, the famous Empire from Star Wars, or immensely old and powerful spacefaring civilizations, such as the first ones in Babylon 5, which are billions of years older than the younger species. Physicists created a scale in which we categorize hypothetical civilizations by their energy consumption.
Nikolai Kardashev introduced this scale in 1964. We get three types of civilizations. The first one is a planetary civilization, which consumes as much power as the power output of the home planet they live on. A type 2 civilization is a stellar civilization. It consumes as much power as the power output of the entire star. And a type 3 civilization is a galactic civilization. It would consume as much power as the power output of an entire galaxy!
And what type are we on that scale?
Type zero.
But does this scale make sense? Well, we think the concept of huge interstellar empires and powerful gigantic galactic civilizations sounds suspiciously like a human concept. At this point in time, we don't even have any idea how an interstellar empire would look like, since we're so very far away from being an interstellar civilization ourselves. Therefore, all we can do for now is to speculate. The logic here is that if ultra-advanced type 3 civilizations exist, they would surely be gigantic megastructures such as Dyson spheres, and we should be able to spawn them easily.
A Dyson sphere is a hypothetical megastructure named after the astronomer Freeman Dyson, which would be built around a star in order to harvest its entire energy. It is basically a shell made out of solid material, engulfing the entire star it is built around and collecting all its energy. Other variations of this concept include, for example, a Dyson swarm, where millions of smaller energy collectors orbit the star, or a ring structure such as in Larry Niven's Ringworld novels. We have no idea if Dyson spheres are technologically feasible, meaning it could very well be that it is absolutely impossible to build one, even for the most advanced civilizations. Or, of course, they don't make any sense to be built at all, but more on that later. Interestingly enough, a search for Dyson spheres was conducted as part of SETI, where a database of 250,000 stars mapped by the IRA satellite were searched that would emit a specific infrared spectrum, as a Dyson sphere would. But only a few interesting objects were found, which could qualify as Dyson sphere. Among these, the most promising are... Oh my god, not again such names. Okay, let's try. TYC7169-1532-1 and TYC6111-1162-1. Phew! However, it is very probable that these are just stars with a weird infrared emission curve. Follow-up observations are still required to say anything conclusive. New data from the Gaia satellite that mapped 1.7 billion stars in the galaxy might lead to some new interesting discoveries. The most famous example for a possible Dyson sphere, however, which has recently received a lot of attention, is KIC 8462852, also known as Tabby's star. Only a few years ago, it was discovered that this star shows a most peculiar light curve, where extreme dips in brightness were observed. No natural explanation would satisfy these brightness dips. No comets, no planets, no planetary fragments, or other known natural phenomena would produce such a weird light curve. It was therefore proposed that an advanced alien civilization might be building a Dyson sphere around this star, and we would be observing the process of the sphere being built right now. Okay, technically not right now, more like 1470 years ago, because the star is 1470 light years away, and we basically see what happened 1470 years ago, but you know what I mean. More recent observations show that the dips are probably not caused by solid objects, because red light is scattered less than blue light, which is in line with what would happen when light travels through a gas or dust cloud. A solid object would scatter both red and blue light the same way. Therefore, the most probable explanation are giant dust clouds between us and the star. But even this has not been conclusively proven.
But we should keep in mind that maybe it doesn't make any sense to build Dyson spheres. The same way that back in the 19th century, people imagined a future powered by steam, when in fact only shortly afterwards, steam became absolutely inefficient due to newer technologies. And no one would build a huge steam spaceship, would they?
Commander to machine room. Ensign, prepare the steam drive.
Aye, Commander. But we're running out of coal reserves.
I thought we loaded up on coal the last time at space dock.
Yeah, but it was low quality coal. We've used it up already.
Damn it! And don't even get me started on extremely over-the-top, ultra-large megastructures like the Xeely Ring in Stephen Baxter's Xeely novels. Even though I really love this idea. Building something that large is probably absolutely impossible. Physics simply prohibits it. And that's probably why we'll never find anything like this ever.
So, to sum it up, stellar-scale megastructures probably don't exist. Because they either don't make sense or are impossible to be built.
Unfortunately, spaceships are just too small to be discovered by our current technology. We wouldn't be even able to spot a gigantic armada of thousands of star destroyers or kilometer-sized spaceships in the orbit parked around the nearest exoplanet Proxima B, which is just 4.3 light years away.
So let's do a quick calculation in order to illustrate this. Don't worry, I promise it will be easy. We'd like to know what kind of resolution we would need to detect the Death Star in orbit around Proxima B. So we insert the distance in kilometers, 1 light year is 9.46 times 10 to the 12 kilometers, so the distance is 4.3 times 9.46 times 10 to the 12 kilometers, and the diameter of the Death Star is around 160 kilometers. Doing some school math, we get a required angular resolution of around 14 nano arc seconds. Let's compare this to the currently highest resolution ever achieved, which will be used to make a picture of the central black hole of the Milky Way, Sagittarius A star, which is roughly 26,000 light years away. The diameter of the event horizon of Sagittarius A star is 12 million kilometers, so we get a required angular resolution of 9.78 micro arc seconds. For this, dozens of radio telescopes around the world are connected to each other via interferometry to create a virtual telescope with the required resolution in order to make a picture of the event horizon of Sagittarius A star. However, we would need a telescope with 1,000 times this resolution to spot the Death Star in orbit around Proxima B.
So, we can totally forget finding alien spacecraft or spaceships in the near future with our current technology. No chance. Well, we are of the opinion that alien life exists with a probability of 100.0%, like 100, like 100.
100?
100?
100.
100% probability for alien life.
100%!
We should not be surprised by this apparent silence, for that is exactly what it is, an apparent silence.
The Fermi Paradox tells us more about our own arrogance and self-centeredness and our current state of technological development and, quite frankly, our own stupidity, than does it tell us about the non-existence of alien civilizations.
We haven't been looking long enough, and to top it off, we probably have been looking the wrong way. But we are certain that we will find them in time.
I hope you liked our two-part series about aliens. Be sure to subscribe, be sure to like, and share it with all your friends, family, grandchildren, grandparents, acquaintances, people you met only once in your life. Doesn't matter.
Let's wish everybody Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
In 2019, more awesome sci-fi instinct is waiting for you.